5 frogs were sitting on a log. One decided to jump. How many are left? Story to be shortly continued. The brain gives rise to all our mental experiences. It causes our emotions, our actions, our decisions and thoughts. But it's not this homogeneous processor that uses predictable computations to come up with logical actions. Instead, it's likely to be a dual brain or a dual processor. With the first system is a conscious, logical one, and the other is a reflexive, non-conscious one. So the conscious brain is logical within our awareness, intentional, but it asks you for 2 things. Time, because it's slow, and it asks you for your willingness to exert effort. In return, it'll make you feel like you're in control of what you're doing, somewhat efficient. The other mind is the non-conscious brain. It is reflexive, it's fast, outside your awareness, but it's effortless. And it causes all your mental reflexes. We all like to think that we're in control 100% of the time. I know I do. But many studies in the field of psychology have shown otherwise. That actually the hero, the hidden persuader, is not the logical, conscious mind, but it's rather the reflexive, non-conscious mind that's running the show most of the time. Paradoxically, when I first started studying the field of psychology, the first lesson that I learned was, we are in control. We just need to decide, to make the decision, the intent. And I'm sure all of you have heard the cliche that nobody can make you feel inferior or embarrassed unless you give them permission to. But words have power. Because saying that is kind of like saying, upon our orders, our logical mind is going to dress our egos in a shield that protects us against painful and hurtful words. Unfortunately, though, it comes in a bit too late. After the non-conscious mind has shrunken our egos as a result of listening to these words to a size that's too small for the in-preparation logical shield. Words have power. Words have started wars. Words have spread peace. Words have pushed him to attempt suicide, but words have prevented him from jumping off a bridge. Words have made her give up on school, but words have paved a trajectory of possibilities for her. Words have power because they activate mindsets and scripts that we all do and have about ourselves that are consistent with the words that are being said. Why? Because then the non-conscious mind can use self-fulfilling prophecy, finding mindsets that match these words because it likes the easy way out, and the easy way out is to make a coherent story that's absent or doesn't have exceptions. Because making a complex story that's full of exception is so much harder to do, and it requires effort. Consider this study. They had participants come in, and they said, here are some words to play with. I want you to arrange them in a way that's grammatically meaningful. Sentences like, let's play bingo. Now, for some of the participants, they were primed, they played with some words that had to do with, like, elderly-related words. Bingo, Florida, gray. The other participants didn't. And then they said, thank you so much for your participation in this experiment. Do you mind just doing one more thing? Just walk down the hall to this other office for this some unrelated thing. Now, the participants didn't know, but the researchers were measuring how long it will take them to walk down the hall. And as it turned out, the participants that were primed with elderly-related words walked slower than the other group. So the words can affect our actions. Now, the words around us can have priming effects that are a bit more costly than walking slowly. For example, for Asian American participants, they gave them a math test. But then when they were reminded before the test of their ethnicity, their performance in math went up. When they were reminded of their gender, female, their performance went down. Okay? So words have power. Words have power even if you're going to use them as a metaphor. Because then what the brain is going to do, it's going to react to the psychological use of the word by actually activating the sensory areas in the brain that represent the physical experience of these words. For example, when we describe someone as soft-hearted, the word soft actually activates sensory neurons that are activated when we touch a smooth, soft object. When we describe a situation as rough, a different group of neurons that are activated during the sensory, the physical feeling of rough surface is going to be activated. So we inherited kind of stories and scripts from our previous ancestors that probably says something like soft and furry is comfortable and safe, and rough surface tends to be painful. And thus, we stayed consistently and linguistically okay with that story and kept using it psychologically to mean painful and comfortable. Now, the brain is not just a sensation translator machine. It also does perception. So we can, I guess, define perception as the story that the brain makes given the sensory input it gathers from the environment. Now, this perception or this story does not need to be accurate or realistic or complete. And in fact, it's often not. As long as it serves the non-conscious mind and is consistent with the goals of the logical mind. Some of these perceptual things that we gather from the environment are automatic and outside our consciousness. So for example, if I ask you to name the color of the words. Okay, pretty easy to do. Now, if I ask you to look at the words and don't read it, don't process the color, just look at it, don't do anything with it. Impossible. Because your non-conscious brain, when you look at a word, whether you like it or not, is going to make you automatically read it, regardless of how many instructions I give your logical mind. Now, let me invite you to a match between your consciousness and your non-consciousness in this next task, the Stroop Test. Here, the color, as you will notice, is inconsistent with the word. So I'm going to invite you again to not read the word, but rather name the color. Go for it. Much harder, isn't it? Much harder. Why? Because your non-conscious mind is fast, effortless. It takes the easy way out to perception. And the easy way out is to read the word. And then you appeal to your conscious mind and say, but I want to follow the instructions. I don't want to make mistakes. I'll give you what you want. I know you want time and you want effort. I'll give it to you. So then you slow down your reaction time so you don't make mistakes, and you make quite a bit of effort to get this right. So you're thinking, okay, the Stroop Test, we don't live in a lab. Does this happen in the outside world? That's really what you care about. And so let me take you to Social Etiquette 101. We all learned, do not judge people. But here is the thing. This is very similar instruction to look at a word, don't process it. Don't read it. Don't name its color, don't think anything about it. Unless your eyes are closed, it's impossible to do. Judgment is a non-conscious, automatic, reflexive thing that the brain does. When you meet people, you're gonna make judgments. These are gonna be expectations and thoughts that are gonna be consistent with mindsets that are pre-programmed. And of course, if these mindsets have to do with race, they're called stereotypes. Now, all professionals, or at least most of them, have to attend some sort of workshops and trainings to make sure they battle things like racism and prejudice and the like. Here is the thing, is that most of these workshops target and persuade the logical, conscious mind, but they don't target the non-conscious mind. Most of these miscomputations, though, are actually reflexes of the non-conscious mind, though. So perhaps at best these workshops will be efficient in reducing deliberate actions of racism or prejudice, but what about implicit ones? And we know that implicit kind of attitudes affect judgment and decisions, and we know they exist. Why? Because fMRI tells us so. Numerous fMRI studies have showed that when we put participants in a scanner and we expose them to faces of people of different races, different skin tone, that what we see that there is differential amygdala activation to the different races. What is the amygdala important for? Well, the amygdala is a brain part that's activated or processes fear and threat. Interestingly, the amygdala activation is correlated with implicit measures of these negative attitudes toward others, but not explicit measures. So when we give people questionnaires about their attitudes toward other groups, and they just pass with flying colors, and it's not that they're lying in the questionnaire, that's what their logical, conscious brain is providing on that piece of questionnaire. So for any kind of efforts to be successful, it has to wed both. Now, you might be thinking, well, I kind of want to know where I stand on my implicit judgments toward people, because I thought I love everybody, including trees. So what should I do? And an fMRI scanner didn't exactly come with my furniture set. No worries. There is a behavior test that you can take online that's called the Race Implicit Association Test. Go ahead and expose yourself, probably privately, because you will be shocked. I personally would urge people who do the training on these kind of workshops to give implicit tests that are reputable and have shown reliability to really show that they worked. I would urge that hiring committees would take such tests into account, because decisions for a student to get accepted or not, for someone to get hired or not, will be affected not only by explicit, but also by implicit kind of attitudes as well. Right? So for any program to succeed, it must appeal to both the conscious and the non-conscious mind. Now, one program that has miserably failed, particularly in the US, is weight loss program. And it's a paradox, because in 2015, companies whose main business was weight loss services brought in more than $6 billion, but we're still overweight. So what's going on? It seems like the only thing that's getting smaller is the bank account of dieters. Now, many of these diet pills claim that they reduce appetite. But here is the logical problem with that, is that there is no logic. Because it then makes the, kind of like a logical relationship between two questions. Are you hungry and do you want to eat? And the non-conscious system can say, I'm not hungry, but yes, I want to eat. While the logical system will say, no, I am not hungry, no thanks, I don't want to eat. Now, and the non-conscious mind will keep kind of quieting the logical system, particularly for people who restrict their diet. Consider the study. They had people come in, and some people were offered no food. Others were offered one milkshake, so they were moderately full. And others were offered this giant milkshake, so they were really full. And they, then after they did that, they said, do you mind just like rating three flavors of ice cream? Now, the participants don't know really what's going on, but what's going on is that the researchers want to know how much ice cream they will eat as a function of being not full, little bit full, or very full, and taking into account whether you're a dieter or not. For the non-dieters, they did the logical thing. When they didn't have anything to eat, they ate more ice cream. When they were full, they ate less ice cream. Very logical. For the dieters, though, what they did was the opposite of that logical script. So the first group were the non-dieters. Now, the dieters, what they did, is the opposite of logic. When they weren't offered food, when they were hungry, they had the least amount of calories. When they were, the more full they were, the more calories they had. It's as though the non-conscious mind had this reflex saying that, violate your diet, go all the way. You know we all did it, okay? So again, for weight loss programs to work, they have to really appeal to both the conscious and the non-conscious mind. I think that we should try to implicitly program very early in life, Like, why not have cartoons or more cartoons where the main character is broccala, a broccoli, that is affable. And she has all of these helpers that are vegetables of all colors and so attractive, and kids are fascinated by them. And don't tell me that can't be done, because if you can get kids to be interested in one-eyed characters, you can get them to like broccala. I mean, I would rather have a vegetable monster than a cookie monster. Why not? So, by now it's become clear that if your two minds are gonna wrestle, that it's probably the reflexive, non-conscious one is the one that's gonna typically win, for three reasons. One is that it's fast. It comes on the scene much faster. Two is that the logical mind requires effort, and we are lazy thinkers. In fact, we're so lazy, and this is so prevalent, that psychologists came up with a law. It's called the law of least effort. And some social psychologists have even called us cognitive misers. Two and three is that when brain damage happens, stroke, whatever happens, the last thing to be compromised is the non-conscious mind. So now the question becomes, can we do anything about this? Can we reprogram our non-conscious mind? Or are we just gonna be at the whim of these reflexes that we can't do anything about? The answer is yes, yes, and yes. Just like the ads that show up, the annoying ads that show up, but they're tailored to you, though, because they take into account your own history. Sometimes they're embarrassing. And what I want to say, my dear sisters and brothers, in the law of least effort, that you have successfully already preconditioned and reprogrammed your non-conscious mind to produce reflexes called habits. If we can train the brain to use brain waves to play video games, if we can successfully train the brain of cortically blind people to see, identify correctly objects they can't see using other types of energy like sound, if we can use the brain and train it to use brain waves to move prosthetic arms, you can recondition your non-conscious mind so it's reflexing in your favor, not against you. Oh yeah, what happened to that one frog that decided to jump? Nothing, it didn't. There's still five frogs in the log. Thank you.